Welcome to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis, the birthplace of Congregational Humanism. We carry on that tradition of free thought today, dedicated to promoting a free search for truth, meaning, and justice. Our web address is firstunitarian.org. I'm David Breeden, Senior Minister. Welcome. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to First Unitarian Society of Minneapolis on this Sunday, May 14th, Mother's Day 2023. I'm David Breeden. I'm the Senior Minister. I'm joined today by our Music Director, Mike Vosich, and by our accompanist, Amos Lucidi, by our Ministerial Intern, David Buckley, and the Chalice Choir. Thank you, everybody. Yay! The beautiful flowers here today are left over from the celebration of life yesterday of our FUS member, Nancy Miller. Thanks to all of our volunteers who helped out with that. We had a great crowd yesterday. And if you see a little brochure around, Nancy was a poet, and there's some great little poems in that, and you can learn a little more about Nancy and see some of her paintings in the brochure that is around this morning. Our programming is on-site, live, online live, and on-demand 24/7. Thanks to Jacob Mullis and our AV team back there. Thanks a lot. If everyone, wherever you are, would look to your right and to your left and say, I am so glad you're here today.
I am so glad you're here today.
Yeah, we're glad you're here today, absolutely. First Unitarian Society is a member congregation of the Unitarian Universalist Association of Congregations. Welcome everyone to this place of love and justice, this place where we attempt to live up to humanity's highest ideals, highest hopes, and yeah, we fail. Yes, we do, but we try again and again. Welcome everyone, where we try to be the place that we dream of in our own society, in the larger world, giving, loving, compassionate people, a place of love and justice. Thanks, everyone, for being here today.
All right. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers in here today. My wife, Molly, is here today. Happy Mother's Day. Yay. And my mom is maybe watching. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. And so it is, it's a great day for, I thought it'd be fun to program music by mothers. So there's the music today is all the composers were or are mothers. The first one is a piece by Florence B. Price. It's going to be a work for organ that was written in 1951. And Florence B. Price was an African-American composer. Her daughter's account of her said that she wanted to be a physician. She was born in 1887, and she decided that was going to be too difficult a career path for women, so she chose the more difficult career path of being a composer, and she was the first first woman, African-American woman, to have a symphony premiered in Chicago in 1933 at Chicago Symphony Orchestra. So she's got an incredible legacy. And this is a piece, right before she died in 53, this was a piece written at the end of her life. And then the Chalice Choir is here going to sing two pieces, one by a local composer named Elizabeth Alexander, who does a lot of writing for UU churches and just other settings. And according to her website, she said one of her greatest joys in life is playing music with her son. There's a nice photo of them jamming together, which I loved. And then the last piece is by a young mother who graduated from Smith in 2008. And she's a contributor of that Justice Choir songbook, which we've performed out of before. And now she's the choir director at Amherst. And this is the piece that she wrote for the Justice Choir songbook. And she's got a couple of young children. So that's the program today. Thanks, Chalice Choir, for being here. And hope you enjoy.
Mike. That's wonderful. So when we gather for our assembly here, First Unitarian Society, one of the symbolic rituals we share is to light a chalice, which represents our common values that we come together to strengthen and reinforce. And each week, we highlight one of these values by reading either one of the principles of principles of Unitarian Universalism or one of the aspirations of First Unitarian Society, all of which you can see listed on our website. So while Paul lights the chalice, I'll read the fourth aspiration of First Unitarian Society, which is, we aspire to support one another's journey toward meaning and connection in the here and now. And then if you could all stand for the congregational song here, number 1007, there's a river flowing in my soul. And the words will be up here as well. Standing, if you would, and join me in the congregational covenant. Love is the spirit of this place, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.
Please be seated. Thank you. First Unitarian Society is a congregational humanist community, which means that we are here for each other, our neighbors, and our planet. On Sundays when we gather, we take a few moments to reflect on the joys, sorrows, and milestones of the human experience, and we do this in order to stay in touch with our own humanity and to remind ourselves of the value of a moment of stillness. Well, yes, it is Mother's Day, which is both beautiful and problematic. Besides the long lines at restaurants today, I hope you've got your reservation already. Yeah, but some of us have lost our mothers. Some of us have problematic relationships with our mothers. Some of us are mothers with problematic relationships with our children. Some of us wish to be mothers, but can't be for various reasons. Some of us never wanted to be mothers and feel singled out by a society that thinks everybody, every female, should be a mother. All of these things add up, so let's give ourselves a little slack here, love on ourselves a little bit, and remember, it's Caretaker's Day. How about that? Yeah. Let's accept the problematic and enjoy the spring and hope, and a brunch later, if that's in the cards. A joy! FUS member Catherine Abbott is celebrating her 102nd birthday. And hello, Catherine, because she does join us online. Believe it or not, she celebrated her 100th back when we were still completely online, and we were able to say hi, and I'm sure she's watching today. FUS member Rebecca Chesson reports, quote, "I'm taking in all the good wishes I can gather for an upcoming double surgery. I'll be off work and recuperating for a couple weeks, so post-op amusements and distractions will be much appreciated. Cards, calls, emails, texts, please." And Rebecca notes that she's an enthusiastic student of Ikebana, and that you see the decoration there, quite beautiful, a Japanese-style flower arranging, and that nature is important to her as a touchstone. Downstairs today, we will have cards that you can send in the card basket to both of these folks and any, some of our other shut-ins. Now we're going to take a few moments to reflect on violence, oppression, and those who work for hope and restoration in our world.
I invite everyone who enjoys stories to settle in, get ready for a story about stories, about someone writing the story of the world around them and their place in it. Let's see what happens. Harold and the Purple Crayon by Crockett Johnson. That may come up on the screen there. There we go. All right. So one evening, after thinking it over for some time, Harold decided to go for a walk in the moonlight. There wasn't any moon, and Harold needed a moon for the walk in the moonlight, and he needed something to walk on. He made a long, straight path so he wouldn't get lost, and he set off on his walk, taking his big purple crayon with it. But he didn't seem to be getting anywhere on the long straight path, so he left the path for a shortcut across a field, and the moon went with him. The shortcut led right to where Harold thought a forest should be. He didn't want to get lost in the woods, so he made a very small forest with just one tree. It turned out to be an apple tree. The apples would be very tasty, Harold thought, when they got red. So he put a frightening dragon under the tree to guard the apples. There was a terribly frightening dragon. It even frightened Harold. He backed away. His hand holding the purple crayon shook. Suddenly he realized what was happening. But by then, Harold was over his head in the ocean. He came up thinking fast, and in no time, he was climbing aboard a trim little boat. He quickly set sail, and the moon sailed along with him. After he had sailed long enough, Harold made land without much trouble. He stepped ashore on the beach, wondering where he was. Sandy beach reminded Harold of picnics, and the thought of picnics made him hungry. So he laid out a nice, simple picnic. There was nothing but pie. But there were all 9 kinds of pie that Harold liked best. When Harold finished his picnic, there was quite a lot left. He hated to see so much delicious pie go to waste, so Harold left a very hungry moose and a deserving porcupine to finish it up. And off he went, looking for a hill to climb to see where he was. Harold knew that the higher he went, the farther he could see, so he decided to make the hill into a mountain. If he went high enough, he thought, he could see the window of his bedroom. He was tired and felt he ought to be getting to bed. He hoped he could see his bedroom window from the top of the mountain, but as he looked down over the other side, he slipped, and there wasn't any other side of the mountain. He was falling in thin air, but luckily he kept his wits in his purple crayon. He made a balloon and grabbed onto it, and he made a basket under the balloon big enough to stand in. He had a fine view from the balloon, but he couldn't see his window. He couldn't even see a house. So he made a house with windows, and he landed the balloon on the grass in the front yard. None of the windows was his window. He tried to think of where his window ought to be. He made some more windows. He made a big building full of windows. He made lots of buildings full of windows. He made a whole city full of windows, but none of the windows was his window. He couldn't think of where it might be. He decided to ask a police officer. The officer pointed the way Harold was going anyway, but Harold thanked the officer. And he walked along with the moon, wishing he was in his room and in bed. Then suddenly, Harold remembered. He remembered where his bedroom window was when there was a moon. It was always right around the moon. Then Harold made his bed, and he got in and drew up the covers. The purple crayon dropped to the floor, and Harold dropped off to sleep. A lovely story, right? But whose story was it? Who do you have? Oh yeah, the crayon. I like that. Whose story? Anybody else? Well, remember the first slide. The author was Crockett Johnson, so I suppose it's Crockett's story. But inside Crockett's story, Harold was creating his own story, right? Did Harold know what he was going to write when he started? No, in fact, there were times where he didn't really like where the story was taking him. How did Harold deal with that? Yeah, kept writing. Yeah, he kept drawing, kept creating. I think he managed to write a pretty fun story, found a pretty good place for himself in the end, right? So as we go into this week, let's keep thinking of what ways we get to write or rewrite our story and the story we're a part of, okay? Great. Then the kids can write their stories about going down to RE, and the rest of us will sing you out.
Thank you.
Excuse me while I do my costume change here. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was Arg. So begins the sacred scripture of the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster. The website for the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster says this, quote, "Religious texts tell us that humans evolved from pirates." Consider that so-called science experts, would have us believe humans evolved from primates, pointing out the shared 99% shared DNA between humans and primates. But humans and pirates share upwards of 99.9% DNA. We believe that pirates were the original Pastafarians and that they were peaceful explorers. It was only due to Christian misinformation that they have an image of outcast criminals today. No one knows, they say, right, what the afterlife really holds, but we are told FSM, Flying Spaghetti Monster, heaven has a beer volcano and stripper factory. I have no idea what a stripper factory is either, but... Well, what is this business about pirates and beer volcanoes? I want to take a look at a Pastafarian picture here. It's a look at four people at some sort of a rally. I guess it's a college campus rally, I suppose, of some sort. But look closely, and yes, we have our Pastafarian there, right? Now, two of the people in the picture are Christians of a particularly fundamentalist stripe. Well, I'm there to tell the drunks, homosexuals, abortionists, etc., that they are doomed to hell. The other two are Pastafarians, followers of the Flying Spaghetti Monster. Sure, the depth of tradition, you know, a couple of thousand years worth of tradition, after all, is on the side of those Christians. But notice that they are not smiling. They are not having fun. The two Pastafarians, on the other hand, have smiles on their faces. Who would you rather be? Oh, you might be thinking, but Christianity is... what, true? Older? What? It's a real-world question to ask. Since you're listening to my voice today, chances are you chose something other than fundamentalist Christianity to be your life's path. But you are, of course, just as free to go back and join those two frowning guys. Both are religious options. And there are, what, thousands? Millions of different religious options out there, somewhere in between the frowns and the smiles, maybe. Now, give some thought to just how complex human religions can get. What's the difference between Baptists and Presbyterians? Yeah, that should be a test on the seminary, right? How many pages of theology are there to those traditions? Billions. And then Baptists and Presbyterians, there are dozens of splinter groups that believe just this little bit less or more or whatever. A lot of trees have died for religion. And who even keeps track of this stuff after a while? All the thought, all the speculation, the accretions of revision after revision on top of revisions. Religious traditions are the very essence of hidebound. Let's consider for a moment one example, the 5 points of Calvinism, often memorized by the acronym TULIP. T, total depravity. U, unconditional election. L, limited atonement. I, irresistible grace. P, perseverance of the saints. T, tulip, it sounds really pretty, doesn't it? Until you start considering the concepts that the acronym sums up. Total, unconditional, limited, irresistible. This is a story that says most of humanity, through most of human history, from the distant past into the future, billions upon billions of human beings are damned eternally to torment, and they have no choice in the matter whatsoever. That's not such a pretty tulip. Total depravity? Imagine what it does to a kid's mind to be told, you were born totally depraved. Well, I don't have to imagine it because I was as a kid. The only difference being that the tulip Calvinism and the holiness Pentecostalism that I grew up with, we believed that you could get out of eternal damnation by bringing it all to Jesus. You have free will and you can get out of that, which is kind of the essence of American self-help culture, isn't it? Europeans brought tulip, but most Americans have gone for the, you can change your life and do something else. All of these are ideas, dogmas, they're the products of the fertile human mind. They're stories, as Buckley was mentioning. Stories about what it means to be human. Stories about what we human beings can do and should do. Think of all the human energy through the ages spent on trying to explain and document what it means to be human and how to be human in the world. Go to any seminary and just start with A, right? You will not finish. Think of all the human energy that has gone into concepts of hell, that eternal lake of fire, and Harold with his purple crayon. Hell or Harold? We do have a choice. Some of us are smiling and some of us are not. Have you ever noticed that we often hear about the war between science and religion, but never about the war between science and poetry? When was the last time you saw a documentary on it? Why don't we hear about the war between science and poetry? Because they occupy two categorical differences. We understand they're different categories of things. Science is about experimentation to reach conclusions about a consensus reality. Consensus reality. We can agree on this consensus reality. Poetry is about the use of language to express a subjective reality. And here's what I want to propose for your consideration today. Religion and poetry and the arts with a capital A, like music, yes, are all in the same category, I propose. And that category is the human imagination. One of the interesting and problematic things about the word religion is that we don't even know what the etymology of it is. We don't know where it came from, and therefore we don't know what the original meaning of the word was. The Roman writer Cicero, who died in 43 BCE, speculated that the Latin noun religion came from the Latin verb religare, re again, ligare, to bind. Lig as in ligaments, right? The ligaments that keep your muscles, to rebind. Now, we don't believe that many things that Cicero thought about science, etc., and he was a folk etymologist, but this is as close as we get to even understanding where the word possibly came from. Many people through the years have accepted Cicero's surmise, and so it's caught on due to its folk nature and its assumptions, but the problem is, what does it mean? To rebind. The question is, to what? The sacred? the earth, the primal forces and powers of the universe, the vast cosmic consciousness? Is this rebinding because we lost the binding that we had when we were born? Are we returning to something that we have forgotten over time? Up I forgot as down I grew, or down I forgot as up I grew, as E. Cummings would say it. Are we being repatriated into some kind of a land of what? Holiness? Wholeness? Are we restored? What's the re? I don't really know. Dr. T.M. Lerman is a professor of religious anthropology at Stanford University. She grew up a Unitarian Universalist and an agnostic. She researches how people believe in gods. That's her thing. How do people actually believe? Her most recent book is How God Becomes Real, Kindling the Presence of Invisible Others. All right? How God Becomes Real, Kindling the Presence of Invisible Others. Dr. Lerman is as skeptical as you or me. However, she knows that people all over the world do feel the presence of their gods. They manifest them. How do they do that? And her answer is play. Play. Think for a moment about a child pretending to be a lion or a dog. Okay? Children know perfectly well that they don't actually become lions or dogs or dragons or firefighters. They know they aren't really that. They're only pretending. By the same token, children know that if you or I pretend to be a lion or a dog or a dragon or whatever, actually we are not those things, no matter how loudly we growl, right? They might scream and run away and pretend fright or whatever, but they are not in fact confused between play and reality. They know the difference. Dr. Lerman claims that religious belief is exactly like that. We know that what we think in religious terms is not real in the way that a tree we see outside the window is real. An example Lerman gives us is a devout, sincere person praying for groceries. They're hungry. A person needs groceries and prays to their gods for groceries, but does that person then go to the refrigerator looking for those groceries to be there? Most people don't. How do they know the difference? They're playing a game. Most people understand that there's a difference between religious reality and consensus reality. That's why we're not all in one big church in Minneapolis this morning, right? There's a difference between those two things. Brain imaging shows that when people pray or talk about their religious ideas or imagine God, it's not the object-oriented parts of the brain that light up. It's the imagination parts that light up. We can feel the difference. Religious thought is imaginative thought. Religious thought is play. It's art. Some of you joined our archive committee last Sunday reading and discussing a talk by John Dietrich, one of our former ministers, on mysticism. One of the striking things about that talk is that even though it was written way back in 1935, it fairly well describes our cultural understanding of mysticism to this day. We just haven't advanced that much in how we think religiously. One reason for that, I suspect, is that we still haven't clarified what a mystical experience even is. Where does it come from? We don't know. Are the realizations we have during a mystical experience, or maybe a drug-induced psychic experience, right? Something like that. It's in our subjective consciousness, but where does it come from? Is it our brains talking to us? Is it the larger universe speaking to us? Or, to look at the matter another way, was perhaps the psychologist Carl Jung correct that mystical and psychedelic experience are revelatory of our subconsciousness? Yes, up here, which is in fact tied to a larger reality that we unwittingly don't notice in our day-to-day lives. The spiritus mundi, the spirit of the world, as they used to call it back in the 20th century. We know that there are human experiences that are unutterable and ineffable. No words. You can't say what it was like. We know that. In his talk, John Dietrich quotes from William Wordsworth's poem with the super long title, Are You Ready? Lines composed a few miles above Tintern Abbey on revisiting the banks of the Wye during a tour July 13, 1798. How's that for an exciting title? In the poem, Wordsworth attempts to get at a mystical experience. Let me read a little bit from the poem. For I have learned to look on nature not as in the hour of thoughtless youth, but hearing oftentimes the still sad music of humanity, nor harsh nor grating, though of ample power to chasten and subdue. And I have felt a presence that disturbs me with the joy of elevated thoughts, a sense of sublime, of something far more deeply interfused, whose dwelling is the light of setting suns and the round ocean and the living air and the blue sky and the mind of man, a motion and a spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of all thought, and rolls through all things. Therefore am I still a lover of the meadows and the woods and mountains and of all we behold from this green earth. Of all the mighty world of eye and ear, both what we half create and what perceive, well pleased to recognize in nature and the language of the senses, the anchor of my purest thoughts, the nurse, the guide, the guardian of my heart and soul, of all my mortal being. End quote. Well, that's a famous bit about expressing what you can't express. A classic reflection on the power of nature, and you can see why the American transcendentalists would latch onto that poem pretty quickly, to recognize, quote, in nature and the language of the senses, the anchor of my purest thoughts, the nurse, the guide, the guardian of my heart and soul of my moral being. Well, the human mind is an amazing thing. Each of us lives in the power of our imagination. Sometimes the I, the self, whatever that is, I don't know what myself is, I've said before, I don't know. Sometimes we feel in charge, don't we? I have to take a couple of little teeny pills to be in charge of my mind each day. I've mentioned before, I was born depressed, right? So that helps me have a subjective experience that's not quite as dark, right? However you get there, right, who's in charge? Sometimes we are it. Sometimes we feel compelled. Sometimes we feel driven or obsessed or possessed by something we don't know it from where. We hear voices in our head, and where are those voices coming from? Where are the pictures, the images in our minds? Where are they coming from? Why can't I quiet the chatter in my monkey mind, as the Buddhists call it? How much of our own minds do we understand? How much are we in control of? What do we even know about ourselves? Despite decades of research, we're kind of still back in 1935 in terms of our understanding of the religious mind. So yes, Harold and his purple crayon and his amazing imagination can conjure a day of danger and fun and religions and gods and governments. Harold can make all of that up. And sarin gas and war and hatred. It's all from the fruitful human imagination. We are amazing creatures who do not understand the power of our own minds. But let's think back to that picture of the Pastafarians and the fundamentalists. Who is having a good time? Who's enjoying their lives? Who is spreading love and compassion? And who is spreading hate and division? That's the deepest religious secret of all. You choose. You choose the nature of the universe you live in, unconsciously or consciously. Unconsciously or consciously, you choose. I say, let's choose imagination. Let's pick up that purple crayon. And all the people said, Ramen.
Just another invitation to stand as you are willing as able. We have one more congregational song here, Love Will Guide Us. So feel free to sing along as you are able to, and the text will be coming up here on the screen.
Happy Caretaker's Day. I like that very much. I also think of Mother's Day as caretaking Mother Earth, and we can all do that. So, my name is Anne Langard. I'm a member of the Board of Trustees and here to talk with you about two precious commodities, time and money. Precious to each of us and precious to keeping our wonderful First Unitarian Society thriving. First, time. Each of you have an opportunity to serve on the newly formed Upper Assembly Hall Task Force. This, of course, is our beautiful Upper Assembly. This Assembly Hall is the main focal point for gatherings and other activities. This space has seen modifications, including the addition of the media control booth, audio and video enhancements, lighting upgrades, stage elevator access, and window wall replacement. The design and furnishings have remained largely intact according to the original vision of the architect. Recently, there has been a revived interest in a conversation that has happened throughout the years among our congregants to potentially modify the seating and other elements in this room to provide increased comfort and flexibility to this multi-use space. The Board of Trustees recognizes the importance of this discussion and sees the potential for improving the assembly experience by considering changes to the seating, flooring, and other elements that define this space. In support of this effort, the Board seeks to create a task force that would take on the work required to discern opportunities, develop design options, and evaluate costs. This task force would be asked to develop a plan and a proposed budget for consideration by the board and congregation. Members and friends who are interested in participating can volunteer by leaving their name in the office or by emailing a board member or a minister by the end of the month, so the end of May. And we welcome all voices and all help with this important conversation. As for the money, priority number two. We're a nonprofit organization, as you all know, and we have a slim budget of just under $1 million annually. We do pretty remarkable things for just under $1 million, I'd say. About one half of that support comes from you and me. And if you're moved by what you hear today, please consider a donation today. Stop by the office with your gift or go to firstunitarian.org and click the Give button in the upper right corner. We should put a smiley face next to that Give button because it'll make you feel really good if you give. I thank you for your time and your money today and every day.
All right. Thank you, Anne.
Thank you.
Few announcements. After assembly today, those in the building can enjoy conversation and a mini meal, Mexican lasagna over yellow rice, which is vegetarian, or Lebanese red lentils and rice and naan, which is vegan, and can't be beet, B-E-E-T, cake. All right. Join us downstairs. Also, stop by the Active Voices table, see what they happen to be up to. If you're new to FUS and would like to know more, we do have a welcome table downstairs. Also, if you want to find out more about our congregation, we will be having a pathway to membership. Stop by the welcome table, but also go by Rev Kelly's office at 1215 today. Buckley will be there waiting for you. It's out this door to the left, and it's the first door past the little gateway here. To the right. That's Rev Kelly's office. And join us. She's running back from Northfield, where she was speaking on reproductive justice this morning, but she will be back at 12:15. At noon today, in this room, join FUS board members discussing details of our proposed 2023-24 fiscal year budget. This is your budget. The board and I, and we've been working, and the finance committee have been working on what we can do with next year with projected funds, and they will be going through that fairly minutely, and you can ask questions at noon today. And then, of course, the annual meeting next week, where democracy rules, and you vote on that budget and other things for our next fiscal year. It's democracy in action. One more little thing. Do mark your calendar, because Saturday, June the 17th at 6 p.m. out on our patio, because we know it's going to be beautiful weather. We've already put in a work order for it. It's going to be sunny out there, and we're going to be playing giant Jenga and ladder ball and cornhole toss and whatever games you happen to bring along, a yard game. So that is Saturday, June 17th at 6 p.m. And you can keep up with everything going on at FUS through our Friday update. Sign up for that at our website, and also through our various social media outlets. So thank you very much. If you will repeat with me, please, our extinguishing the chalice words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. All of these we carry in our hearts and in our minds until we are together.
I will rise for all the weary, for each lonely refugee. I will.
Go out into the world. Be fearless. Ask questions. Hold on to what is good. Strengthen the weak. Comfort the fearful. Serve the suffering. Do what makes you come alive. Because, as the great Howard Thurman said, the world needs more people who have come alive. So may it be.